Wavesound Audiobooks presents an unabridged recording of Fighting Fate by Justin Yerbury, narrated by Nick Rheinberger. For Mum and Sarah. He who has a why to live for can bear almost any how. Friedrich Nietzsche. Foreword by Jane Hawking. I much regret that I was not in Cambridge when Chris Dobson, the master of St. John's College, brought Justin Yerbury to meet my then husband, Stephen Hawking. Through Justin's account of that meeting, I now have an insight into the friendship that was established between Justin and Stephen on that occasion, but at that time had no idea of the scope of Justin's groundbreaking research, nor of his persistence in achieving it. It's thanks to this, his memoir, that I can appreciate the importance of Justin's scientific achievements, and I'm honoured to be asked to write the foreword to his memoir. Fighting Fate runs the gamut of human experience and emotion, from the carefree joy of a dedicated husband, father, and sportsman, to deep anxiety about Justin's family background, which led him to enrol for a degree in science. That, in turn, fired in him a determination to succeed in the academic arena, with the result that he worked towards a PhD. The anxiety was still there, however, compounded by fear for the future. It compelled him as a postdoctoral researcher to concentrate on the science of the fatal familial version of motor neurone disease, MND, which he discovered had plagued his family for generations. Then began years of battling for grants for the survival of his group, his research into chemistry, genetics and biology, and his own income. Such is the precarious financial existence of young scientists. By 2008, Justin's research was yielding startling results, but in the cut and thrust of life in science, his attempt to publish them was outpaced by another similar paper from a different source on the same subject. Deeply disappointed, Justin had to learn the hard lesson that science is as competitive and ruthless as any sport on the games field. Stephen learned that lesson the hard way when he presented papers about his work on black holes that contradicted the perceived wisdom of the day, but he succeeded eventually. Justin writes clearly about his work and makes it intelligible for the untutored reader. He tells us about his research into MND, specifically on prions, misfolding proteins in the brain, which are implicated not only in the development of MND, but also Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's. He set himself the task of searching, if not for a cure, then for a life-enhancing and life-extending treatment. He achieved encouraging results, which are nowadays used as a treatment while still undergoing greater investigation and experimentation. Justin brings his own sense of humour to the fore to lighten the scientific details and comes up with astounding statistics, which I'll leave to the listener to discover. Always haunted by his genetic inheritance, Justin's courage in dealing with his eventual diagnosis of MND is impressive, though his sadness is palpable. In his writing, we witness his thoughts as he questioned his fate. Even so, he was determined to continue working. Not only that, he and his devoted wife, Rachel, managed to take their daughters to many of the far-flung places on their bucket list. As well I know, for a person with a disability, travelling the world indomitably is not a straightforward endeavour. What's more, only a few months ago, in 2022, Justin finished writing this powerful and moving memoir. It is a biography, a scientific treatise, and a personal story of a courageous fight against fate involving all his family. Fighting Fate is a heartfelt, honest, and at times heart-rending narrative that catches the reader up in the demands and tensions of a life that is being lived more fully than many others. The circumstances, of course, are some of the most extraordinarily cruel that chance can throw at anyone, and the way that Justin responds to them is very moving indeed. The fact that he's not deflected from his course and is able to follow his life's objective within science is a tribute to his intellectual, mental, and emotional stamina. How he manages to sustain the energy for life in its broadest sense, and for writing this book in particular, leaves me with a sense of utmost admiration. I hope that Fighting Fate will reach a wide readership. It should be compulsory reading for all members of the medical profession, especially of those who come into contact with MND patients. It will give them a much wider picture and understanding of the deeply personal aspects of the illness that they can ever deduce from a consultation. I also wish the book every success in communicating the essence of Justin's story to all members of the public who read it. Hopefully they too will gain a clearer view of the horrors of MND and of the struggles, the fears and the anxieties that its victims and their families have to face. Jane Hawking, Cambridge, 22 March 2023. Foreword by Bec Daniher. I was honoured to have been asked to write the foreword for this book. Justin and I have a shared passion, a shared dream. That dream is for a world without motor neurone disease. MND is a beast. It's a progressive, terminal neurological disease that can strike anyone. People living with MND progressively lose their ability to use their limbs, speak, swallow, and breathe, while their mind and senses usually remain intact. The average life expectancy is just 27 months. Justin's fight against MND began when he and his family learned that they carried a rare genetic form of the disease. Like me, he was drawn into this fight through a personal experience with the disease and has dedicated his life to the search for a cure. Justin has won national and international awards for his efforts and is one of the world's leading researchers into this terrible disease. In a heartbreaking moment, Justin himself was diagnosed with MND in 2016. He can now only communicate with the world through his eyes. He wrote this extraordinary book that way, painstakingly typing one letter at a time with software that interprets his eye movements. All the while, the beast continues to consume him. As the cover of this book says, there can be no sharper lens on life than when you are faced with your own mortality. Justin's determination and that of his family resonates deeply with me. It inspires and moves me to keep fighting. 10 years ago, my family received the devastating news that my dad, Neil, had been diagnosed with MND. Like Justin, Dad had been an athlete, an AFL footballer. After some time to reflect, he responded to the news with determination. He always told us that no matter the adversity you face, there will always be opportunity, and it's up to you to find it. Dad's singular focus is to ensure that those who are diagnosed with MND in the future have a fighting chance to beat this beast of a disease. This can only come from an army of people who share this determination. In 2014, Fight MND was launched to shine a spotlight on MND and to raise funds for vital research to find treatments and ultimately a cure for MND. In that time, through campaigns such as the now famous Big Freeze, Fight MND has invested $69 million into research initiatives and clinical trials, and a further $6.9 million into vital assistive equipment to help improve the lives of those living with MND. We've achieved so much, but the fight isn't over, and there's still so much more to be done. I wish more than anything that we didn't need an organisation like Fight MND, but for now, we do. We joined a club we never asked to be a part of, just like Justin Yerbury. My dad and Justin are similar in many ways, not just because they've defied the odds and dedicated their lives to helping others, as you'll hear in this astounding audiobook. Justin has already done so much to fight MND, and his legacy will be immense. He's been selfless in his crusade and has brought a unique perspective to the fight as someone who literally knows the disease inside and out. That he and his publisher, Affirm Press, are donating all of the proceeds from this book moves us all at Fight MND greatly. Since we started Fight MND, we've known that it was critical to engage as many people as possible in the battle. Like my dad, Justin can no longer speak, but the words on the pages of this book will be heard loudly throughout Australia and beyond. Thank you, Justin, for being such a shining light amid so much darkness. Thank you for buying this audiobook, supporting Fight MND, and for recommending it far and wide so that more can join the fight to end MND. Bec Daniher, Campaign Director at Fight MND. Author's Note. One thing that I've heavily used in my research is a microscope. It's one of the few instruments that can take you to another world. Hours and hours can be lost staring into the depths of the most mind-blowing tiny worlds. Once the specimen is prepared and has been carefully placed onto the microscope stage, I move towards the eyepiece and I notice that the light of the image flickers in and out and wobbles slightly until I'm positioned perfectly. The image is like the flame of a candle, fragile and fickle. But once I've tamed it, the light is unwavering in its bright yellowish glow. Now I must focus. Turning the focus wheel towards the shadowy specimen. Unaware if I'm moving the stage up or down, I focus by feel. Then it happens. The shadowy haze makes way for the crisp, clear image of the cells. A tangle of neurons wrapped in a microscopic embrace. But the microscope can never tell you the whole story. The cells have some depth to them, but at any one moment I can only see a thin slice through the cells. To know what is happening through the entire cell at any single moment in time is impossible. It would be like trying to know what a pig looked like by studying a slice of ham. This book follows the same rules. It is my story, yes, but it is a thin slice of my life with many important people and events left out. This is inevitable. When focused so clearly on particular threads of my life, other moments are just right there but remain out of focus. This is my life under the microscope. Prologue. Standing at the lectern, looking out at the audience, the grip of my anxiety tightened and tightened on my chest until it threatened to suffocate me. I hadn't felt the cold, familiar fingers of fear like this in decades. The tiered seating in the lecture hall was a swollen tsunami of faces about to crash down and swallow me. In high school, my levels of anxiety had bordered on pathological, especially around public speaking. Not now, I told myself. Focus. I've worked so hard for so many years. Trust yourself and just breathe. The room seemed to sway under my feet, so I leaned firmly on the lectern to prop myself up. I was at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratories in April 2016 on the private campus in Long Island, New York, which holds the most prestigious conferences in molecular biology. There were more Nobel Prize winners on this leafy campus than in all of Australia. The audience was not large, perhaps 100 or so, although it was not the number, but who they were that was important. The group of people rustling papers in expectation, waiting for me to begin my presentation, were the world's leaders in the field, and now that I had their attention, I felt a strong wave of imposter syndrome flow over me. I'd grown up in a working-class neighbourhood, and I was the first in my family to go to university. I attended a school that didn't have a very academic reputation. Right now, the distance between where I'd started and where I was in this moment seemed too far of a stretch, and it was creating a sinking feeling in my stomach. But that was the least of my problems at that instant. My main concern was my thumb. It wasn't working. No matter how hard I tried, it wouldn't move. The laser pointer didn't sit right in my hand, and that scared the shit out of me. The realization that I was dying hit me like a punch in the face, and I was reeling from it. My head was spinning. Again, I reached for the lectern to keep my balance, my whole weight now bearing down on it. Instead of seeing my life flash before my eyes, I saw my future. A paralysis creeping throughout my body, a wheelchair and a ventilator, culminating with me gasping for air, and then death. I'd seen how this plays out. Fuck! How will I tell Rachel? Fuck! What about the kids? I looked up to see the blinking eyes of the audience in anticipation. The soft murmur of impatient voices began to swell. Okay, focus. I just wanted to first thank the organisers for giving me the opportunity to talk about our work. Today I would like to tell you about some of our work on amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, which is sometimes called motor neurone disease. Chapter 1. Golden Days. I was born in Wollongong Hospital in 1974, 100 years after the first description of the motor neurone disease La Sclerose Laterale Amyotrophique, in English it is Amyotrophic Lateral Sclerosis, or ALS, by the French neurologist Jean-Martin Charcot, commonly known as the father of neurology. I grew up in working-class suburbia, a place where families were supported through industries such as the steelworks, oblivious that such spectacular science was happening across the globe. After my birth, I spent the first few months of my life in and out of the children's hospital, not because any illness had befallen me, but because we were there with my sister Kylie. Apparently, not only did I give my parents a distraction, but I was very popular with the nurses, who loved to play with the big, fat, healthy baby that came along to visit. Sadly, I have no actual memories of my sister, She died from a spina bifida when I was only 3 months of age. The picture I have of her in my mind is from the portrait that hung in the hall of our house at 32 Barton Street, Oak Flats. The photograph, in its thin plastic frame, was an important fixture of the house and the first thing that welcomed you when you entered through the front door. For most of my childhood, the pictures of Kylie, myself, and younger sisters Naomi and Sarah stood sentry over the darkened hallway. It's the one thing that we all shared. A moment in time, each at the same age, captured by the lens of a camera. As a toddler, I could have probably been best described as active. At about 10 months of age, I started to run before learning to walk. The early running start meant I didn't have enough sense to stay out of mischief. Although, as I developed and knew that I shouldn't misbehave, I still did. My mother described me as a tornado. She was a kind, loving, and very maternal woman who lived vicariously through her children. She was a generous soul, and her hugs were warm, safe places. She had an understated beauty that she made little effort to expose. Her brown hair and hazel eyes foreshadowed my own features. She would painstakingly fold washed and ironed clothes into neat, towering piles placed carefully on the brown and yellow tile-topped coffee table. The lounge room had a yellow and orange checked sofa, the coffee table, a TV, and a stereo system that was the size of a side table. The record player often emitted the sounds of my childhood, including the Beatles, Buddy Holly, and the Bee Gees. Turning the AM radio dial quickly through the stations made it talk in a strange language. As soon as Mum took her eyes off me for a second, Hurricane Justin would demolish the fabric cityscape of folded washing in the blink of an eye, undoing all of her efforts. When I was 4 years old, I was given a gold-coloured suitcase, a Vegemite sandwich, and sent off to school. It wasn't clear that I was prepared academically or socially for school, but what was clear was that my mother was ready for me to be busy someplace other than 32 Barton Street. If the teachers wanted proof that I was not prepared for school, they would not have to wait long. Early in that first year, I distinctly remember my kindergarten teacher making each of us stand up in front of the class and announce our street address, a task that most children did easily and proudly. I, on the other hand, was chastised in front of the class for confusing 23 for 32. I think that the teacher felt that I was getting it wrong on purpose. Across all my primary school years, I didn't have a particularly academic reputation. At the end of each school year, additional weight was added to the perpetual discussion about whether I should be kept back in that class to redo that year. Regardless of my age and immaturity, I managed to just keep up with the other kids, so I advanced along with my classmates every year. I can't remember being interested in science at primary school, but I definitely had a general fascination with living things as a young child. I rarely missed an episode of the Australian documentary series The World Around Us, and I was continually looking for lizards and other forms of life under rocks in the garden. My parents encouraged my interest in the creatures living in our garden and bought me my first microscope when I was 10. I was fascinated by the complexity of things down at the micro level, and even once tore a patch of skin off my thumb to take a closer look at my fingerprints. From my earliest days at school, I walked the 600 metres or so from our house to the school gates, often alone. My memories of those days are cloaked in a golden glow. It makes sense to me that perhaps the glow in my memories is because those days were truly a golden period of my life. Like I'm viewing those memories through gold-tinted glasses. It turns out that the golden glow in my memories is not from my warm fondness of this period, but comes down to chemistry. My memories have been reinforced by photographs in our family album, and the photographs of the 1970s used dyes that broke down over time, leaving a golden hue across many of the photographs that has influenced and reinforced my memories. It's humbling to realize that unstable molecules have influenced the way my brain works. My mother had also walked to school as a child, but her days were far from golden. When there was no money for shoes because her father had spent his paycheck on beer at one of the many pubs in the town, she walked barefoot for several kilometres to get to school, and once told me that a way to warm her feet in the depths of winter was to step in fresh cow dung. In contrast, my walk to school was a safe and comfortable, well-worn path, lined by now heritage-listed brushbox trees. I used to know every crack in the pavement better than I knew the people in my class. I was taught that our little town had been designed by Sir Walter Burley Griffin, the architect of Australia's capital city, Canberra. So unique is the streetscape that the layout itself is now heritage listed. The town was centred on the main avenue that pointed visitors and residents alike towards the vistas of Lake Illawarra and the surrounding escarpment. The town was laid out in the 1920s, but the area was originally granted to John Horsley in 1821 and became known as the Oak Flats Run. Even after the town began to take shape, the area was used as a place to run cattle. The streets of Oak Flats that embraced the southern shore of Lake Illawarra were my backyard. While the lake has always been picturesque, it wasn't pleasant to be in, or even near, when I was young. I once walked out into the lake when I was 5 years old, but I turned back to shore when the pungent grey mud reached my knees. It took so long to get the stench off that I've not been in or on the waters of Lake Illawarra since. The lake has since been cleaned up by artificially opening the mouth of the lake to the southern Pacific Ocean, meaning that seagrass no longer rots in the shallows, and the stench is all but gone. One of my first memories of walking the streets of Oak Flats is of taking 20 cents, which my parents called 2 bob, to the corner store so I could choose lollies one by one, which would be put into a white paper bag and twisted so none escaped. Usually I had eaten the sweets before I got back home, so the twist was redundant. Sometimes I'd be sent off down the street with much more money to get cigarettes for my dad. They were Winfield, the ones in the gold packet. I spent day upon day walking or riding my bike around the streets. As long as I was home before the streetlights came on, I had free range. It was probably in an attempt to keep those privileges that I didn't tell my parents when things were not so safe. Like the time I was racing bikes with other kids along Central Avenue. Ironically, I was riding along the footpath where I thought I'd be safe from cars. I was paying too much attention to the others, and I didn't see the car reversing out of its driveway. I hit the back of the car at full speed and tumbled over it in a complete somersault and landed on the concrete. I was not wearing a helmet, because at that time it was not compulsory to do so. That was not to come into law until the late 1980s. I was blacked out for a time, and my first memory is from the walk home on shaky legs. I did not tell my parents. In hindsight, I could have been critically injured and no one would have known. It is a scary thought. Injuries were not always so easy to hide. On one occasion, I gave in to the dares from the other kids and I attempted to use a pile of gravel as a ramp. I hit the ramp at speed and, while in the air, the bike overbalanced and I landed on the front wheel, but could not regain balance. I went over the handlebars and immediately put my arms out to break my fall. I stood up and dusted myself off and noticed the look on the other kids' faces. Something was desperately wrong. I looked down and immediately noticed my arm was just hanging there, broken. It was a complete fracture of the radius and ulna, and at that moment it looked as though I had a second elbow. The arm would need manipulation and would require a stay in hospital, which I didn't realise until I woke in a cold, dark ward in the middle of the night. I was scared and felt abandoned. I cried and then stubbornly stayed awake until my parents came back. At the age of 11, I walked the route to Oak Flats High School for the first time. It was a journey in the opposite direction from primary school in both a literal and metaphorical sense. I was nervous heading into my first day of high school because stories had been circulating among my fellow new students about an unofficial initiation. Word had spread that we could expect to have our heads held in a toilet while it was flushed. I had a feeling that this was going to be a very different experience from my days in primary school. By the end of that first day, I was relieved that I had escaped relatively unscathed. I'd only received a punch to the stomach by the tallest kid in the school after he caught me mimicking his long, loping walk. My initial gut feeling about the coming days of high school would prove to be true, with my experience of this time having an uneasy Lord of the Flies flavour to it. Teenage years are supposed to be a time of personal discovery, a time when your development shapes the person you'll become. But as I moved through those high school days, I didn't really know who I was, and I didn't have a strong enough personality to find my own way. I felt like one of those cube-shaped watermelons grown in Japan. The watermelons are grown within a cube frame that restricts and controls the melon's growth, only allowing it to become the shape that is forced upon it. Just like the square watermelons of Zentsuji, I did not have the freedom to grow into the person that I would naturally have been. I started my first year of high school in the top-graded class, even though I was one of the youngest in the cohort. Being young had some advantages. For example, I competed in the under-12 division for the athletics carnival. With a smaller pool of kids to participate against, I competed at the state level, only just missing out on a medal. That year I broke the school record for high jump that still stands today, 35 years later. You might imagine that being in the top class would mean that there would be limited behavioural issues, but that was just not the case. The class as a group could be brutal and relentless. Once someone showed that a particular insult got under their skin, the taunts grew louder and more regular. I'm ashamed to say that rather than becoming an ongoing target, I joined in on the game. But it was clearly not a game to those on the receiving end. Oak Flats High School was a large campus with several sports fields and basketball courts. When I started, there were over 1,200 students in the school, but the population was skewed to years 7 to 10, with only a dozen or so finishing years 11 and 12. The school was centred on two parallel double-storey buildings, with the whole area smothered in concrete. It was a concrete jungle, or perhaps it could be better described as a zoo. We, the students, provided the wildlife behind barred windows, and the teachers spent more time controlling behaviour rather than teaching. The teachers in high school were a big change from the nurturing guidance I received in primary school. My Year 7 maths teacher had been kicked out of the staff room because of his penchant for smoking at his desk. He was a gruff man with greying hair, large sideburns, and a perpetual white piece of saliva in the corner of his mouth that could be ejected from his mouth if he yelled loudly enough. He would often yell, "Add up the positives, add up the negatives, subtract, use the sign in front of the greater," to teach us the basics of algebra, all the while shaking the blackboard duster up and down to the rhythm of the chant. The duster didn't leave his hand for the duration of the class, except when he threw it at students not paying attention. In PE class, our teacher would threaten us with various forms of torture, such as hanging us from the football goalposts to throw javelins at us, and would always finish his threat with, "And blood will flow." Our history teacher always seemed like he was a living relic from the time of the ancient Egyptians that he taught us about, and was conserving his energy by speaking only a handful of words per lesson, taking long, deep breaths, often with his hands held in front of his face in a praying gesture. I think he often slept through class. My most reviled teacher was an English teacher, Mr. H, who used humiliation as a tool to get students to do their work. He was not afraid to use anything against students, including comments about a student's weight, to get them to be quiet in class. While I was among the top students in maths classes, I was perpetually at the bottom of my class in English. I found subjects that did not have clear answers, such as English, incredibly difficult. Speaking in front of the class and essay writing were particularly challenging. I never felt that I had anything of worth to write in an essay or anything to say to the class that was worth listening to. My anxiety around public speaking bordered on pathological. When I had to speak in front of the class, my stomach would churn, my knees would weaken, and my voice would seemingly disappear. In one particular essay that we were assigned, I could only muster a paragraph after being asked for two pages. In order to motivate me to do better, the teacher held my sparsely populated page up in front of the class, waving it around as if it were a flag flapping in the breeze, poking fun at it and gleefully explaining how pathetic it was. I shrank down in my chair as all heads in the room turned away from the waving page and towards me. My desire to blend in and not draw attention to myself had been found out, and I had the dreadful sense that the teacher would weaponize my anxiety and try to use it against me. However, he didn't bank on how my brain worked and would make sense of the humiliation. Instead of motivating me to write more words, he'd driven me to withdraw even further than I already had. I reasoned that it was logical that if I didn't hand in any work, he could not make fun of it. So that's what I did. But in a surprising act of defiance, I would achieve the highest marks in my class for the English exams in my final year of school. During my early high school years, my grandfather, my father's father, died. Jack, as he was known, was a stubborn, strong man with little to say. He was bald, with a long face. A face which, to my memory, changed expression very little, regardless of what was happening around him. He was well known for his strength and bravery. While he was working in Captain's Flat as a lift operator in an underground mine, he was in a lift accident. The lift fell into the deep water at the bottom of the mine shaft. Despite risks to his own safety, he managed to drag his co-workers out of the cage from the top and to safety. When I was very young, he had a stroke, and much of his right side was paralysed. He later had further blood flow issues that led to gangrenous feet that had to be amputated. This could have been avoided and easily treated if he had seen a doctor before it was too late, but his stubbornness and distrust of the medical profession meant that it went far beyond what should have been a simple treatment. Regardless of his paralysis and his missing feet, he could not be kept from working on his farm. I watched as he ploughed the old granite tennis court with nothing but his wheelchair and a hoe. I like to think that I've inherited some of his dogged determination to get on with things, regardless of disability. I didn't realise until after his death that his name was actually John, not Jack, and I was given my middle name in honour of him. I'm glad that I didn't know that I was named after him until I was older, because I don't think I really understood him in my earlier years. I didn't attend his funeral. I think that in some way, I thought that if I didn't go, it wouldn't be real. In year 10, there was a fracture in the group that I considered myself a part of, and talking to one side meant being shunned and derided by the other, which is what happened to me. Even after everything they put me through, for some reason I still wanted to be accepted by the group. In a way, the group fracture was the final straw. I spent my remaining lunchtimes at school on the basketball court. Basketball saved me from the barbed tongues that made high school such an uncomfortable place. It saved me from my Lord of the Flies deserted island. Not only was it a refuge, but it broadened my sphere, and I no longer had to rely on high school classmates for friendship. The difference between how basketball teammates and classmates treated me was stark. I thought I had found who I was and where I was meant to be. My first memories of basketball are going along to watch my mother and father play at the Lake Illawarra PCYC, which was called the Police Boys Club at the time. I don't remember much about the games, but the squeaking of shoes on the hardwood floor and the stale smell of the sweat of dozens of people on a warm summer evening sticks in my mind. I tried my first game of basketball when I was just 11, but I didn't know the rules, so the only two times I touched the ball, the referee blew the whistle for travelling and cross-court penalties and gave the ball back to the other team. I didn't get back on a basketball court until the concrete courts of high school. It was on that concrete that I learned the basics and did my first slam dunk. Basketball was a great sport for escape. While other sports like cricket or football required two or more people to practice or play, all I needed was a basketball and a hoop. It was indeed my perfect getaway. It helped that the game came naturally to me, and that when I stepped onto the court, the rest of the world disappeared. I'd be selected to represent the Illawarra region in junior basketball teams. My dad was my biggest supporter. Every weekend he would take me to wherever basketball needed me to go. Dad was a relatively tall man at about 6'2", but had a wingspan that must have been closer to 7 feet. He had and still has a square face, a grey moustache, glasses and short hair meticulously parted to one side. He was a very self-confident individual, and I was always in awe of his ease and comfort in speaking to my team or any other group of people. He didn't have a formal tertiary education, but was intelligent and thoughtful. In my mind, he was always a good, decent man. I wanted to be just like him. He'd finished high school at 15 and worked his way from telegram boy to a manager in head office over 35 years, and I respected him a lot. I was still only 16 years old as I entered my final year of high school, meaning that I was a full 2 years younger than some of the students in my grade. My young age, combined with the pressure from other students, meant that I was particularly anxious when it came to girls. My anxiety was embarrassingly crippling. I was much more comfortable being friends with the girls in my class. Other students recognised my awkwardness and would not miss an opportunity to use it against me. The same people who said I was gay for having basketball pictures on my books would taunt me for being interested in girls from our grade. While being called gay wasn't the insult they thought, the relentless nature of the taunts left me no choice but to cave in and change my book covers. As I left high school for the very last time after finishing my final exam, I went to say thanks to my high school basketball coach, Mr. D, as he was the only teacher that I connected with at the school. I wanted to tell him what it meant to me to be part of his team and basketball program. Before I could get those words out, he asked me what my plans for the future were. I explained that I had a plan to make the Illawarra Hawks under-21 basketball team before I turned 18, and, after a couple of years, make the Hawks professional squad. He listened, pondered his 7 years of coaching me, and said, "Maybe you should lower your sights." That was the last straw. My last connection with anyone at the school was burnt to the ground. The school was gone to me. It no longer existed. I walked away, vowing to have nothing more to do with the school, the teachers, or my classmates ever again. Years later, after I'd started to get media attention for my science, the school invited me to come to the end-of-year presentation night to be the guest speaker. I said no. I still felt a deep revulsion for anything to do with my high school, and I couldn't bear the thought of going back, even after 20 years. A conversation with a local surgeon who was working in the same building as me on the genetics of skin cancer, Bruce, was to turn me around. I'd mentioned that I'd gone to high school at Oak Flats after it had come up in conversation. I told him that they'd asked me to come to their end-of-year function and give a talk. Bruce really quizzed me about my reasons for not going. He turned my reasoning on its head. He took my rationale for not going and changed it into a reason to go. He reasoned that the fact that I had personally had a tough time at the school might mean that others were having an equally difficult time. Bruce looked at me across the table and said, "Don't go back for the school. Go back to show the kids that even though you attend the poorest school in the district, you can still find success if you work hard enough." So I called up and said that I was available to give the speech at the presentation night after all. Ironically, I had said yes to the two things that had once made me so anxious: Oak Flats High School and public speaking. In the end, I was glad I went, and I realized how far I'd come. Chapter 2: A New Orbit. New Year's Eve 1991 was without a doubt the single day, from many significant days in my life, whose impact has affected the fabric of my space and time most profoundly. Its reverberations still ripple through every one of my days more than 30 years later. It changed the trajectory of my path through space, so much so that I would end up orbiting a new star, a star that shone brighter than anything I had ever known, and whose warmth would light up my darkest shadows. I had no clue what was about to happen, and I certainly wasn't looking for anything to happen that night. I was not the type of guy who went to a party looking for girls. I'd been enjoying my time away from school now that I'd finished my HSC exams, just hanging out and playing basketball. Mike, one of the basketball crew, was the guy who threw the now infamous New Year's Eve party. I was never a big party person, but I was much more comfortable and at ease with this group of friends than I ever was with anyone in high school, so I was actually looking forward to it. I was wearing some red and black check pants that my mother had made for me, and a black long-sleeved t-shirt, something that I would never have had the confidence to wear in the company of the high school crowd. I would have been anxious, waiting for someone to make fun of them. Thinking this made me realize how comfortable in my own skin I was becoming now that I was away from that place. The only person from high school that I could handle was Syme. He was into the same basketball culture as the rest of us and couldn't care less about what you looked like or wore. He was now sporting a mohawk. I took along with me a bottle of homemade Sambuca that my Uncle Pete gave me, jumped in the car with my mates, and off we went. There were quite a few people at the party, many of whom I did not know. I guessed that most of these were from Mike's high school. Early on in the evening, we bundled into the car to go pick up some more alcohol. It was a small car, old, but in good condition. We fit six people in the car, four squashed across the back leather seats. As we unfolded ourselves from the vehicle, someone noticed that I was wearing a Chicago Bulls cap backwards and suggested it made me look younger, which could foil our plan to look old enough to buy alcohol, given we were all under 18 still. I went back to the car and gave my hat for safekeeping to one of the girls still sitting in the car. The girl's name was Rachel. Rachel had a cute, heart-shaped face, long blonde hair, and a personality many times bigger than a small frame. She was wearing a white crochet top that was more hole than top, maroon jeans and matching maroon Doc Martens boots. My previous anxiety around girls was melted away by Rachel's warmth that night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.